We shall be studying the purpose of the startup class, the methods in the startup class, multiple startup classes, how to configure without a startup, and what are iStartup filters. Let us study them one by one. First of all, let us take up the purpose of the startup class. The purpose is to configure and add additional services to your project. Your project will need database connectivity, the classes, the services that are needed for providing database connectivity, they can be added and configured through the startup class. We will study how in a moment. Startup class is also a place where you can specify how your app will respond to the HTTP requests. HTTP requests are the typed by the customer or your end user in the browser. So this is the request that is coming from the browser. You can specify how your app will respond to these requests. For example, to interpret the various segments of a URL, this is a URL, this is one segment, this is second segment. How will it respond to the various segments? And this is called routing. So your startup class will help you add and configure services, will also help you specify how your application will respond to various HTTP requests. That is, as an example, you can specify how routing will take place. That is, what happens when a customer types something in the URL, whether you are to respond by sending a web API response, or whether you are to respond by downloading a file, or whether by sending some string of data, by sending some JSON, or whatever. So this is a very important class, and it will help you perform these objectives. Your project can contain multiple startup classes. The basic purpose is that if your application is running under development, running under staging, under production, you might want to have different startup configurations. So instead of using preprocessor directives, we give this framework, it gives you the option to name the classes, name the startup classes in such a way that they are automatically picked depending on the production or your development or your staging environment. See, the possible names are startup, another is startup development, startup staging. So this will mean for the development environment, this is for the staging environment. Startup development and startup staging are optional, but if like startup development is present, even though if startup is present and this is present and the app is running under development, then the code in this class will be picked as the code for the startup. And during production, even if this is present, then this will not be used. This class will be used for the startup. So various startup classes are allowed and their names are specified according to the environment. So here we also explain if present startup environment, startup development, startup staging, then the startup class is used according to the environment under which you are running your application. Now we should study the various methods in the startup class. This is the overview of a possible startup class. This is the class. This is the constructor. This is one method called configure. This is the third method called configure services. So Your startup class can contain this, this, and this. There are three possible methods in the startup class that we can provide. Now we will study the details of all the three methods. First of all, let us study about the constructor. The constructor, as we already know, will have the name startup. And you can have three parameters into the constructor. Let me explain one by one. The host injects all available services to the constructor. All available services in your project till the point of startup. So every service that is available will be available in the constructor. This is one thing. I web host environment, I host environment, and I configuration. These are the three services in case of ASP.NET Core generic host. If you are using generic host to configure your ASP.NET Core, in the program.cs file as we have already discussed, then you can make use of these three services that will be available in the startup class constructor. This method is entirely optional, and the purpose is basically to cache cache useful instances, make a read-only private member to store this instance, to store this. These instances, these can be used in the other two methods of the startup class as per need. But you can actually obtain these there also. It is possible by calling various methods. But if you want, you can cache them here by making use of the constructor. The next method is configure services. Public void configure services. Now, the importance of this method is that this method gets a collection of all the services that are available to you. So this collection allows you to add more services to your application. Here the app can add additional services to the DI container. So configure services, the role of this method is to allow you to add more services. Example, you can add services for enabling Razor pages. Details we'll talk later. You can add DB context. This is a class for database connectivity. And you can even add your own classes also. For example, here we are adding our own class CBI class. This class I have explained in one of my previous lectures. During logging I explained, but if you don't understand this, don't worry at the moment. We will explain add singleton, add transient, etc. later on. In rough shell, in nutshell, configure services method allows you to add additional services to the container. This method is entirely optional. It is called by the runtime before the third configure method. So I told you, you have a constructor, you have configure services and configure method. Obviously constructor is called first, then configure services is called, and finally the configure method is called. So you can make note of these things. Let us move to our third method called configure. This is an example of our configure method. Let us try to understand what is this configure method. First of all, let's go through the notes. The purpose is to configure the app's request pipeline, how to handle the HTTP requests. This is one important thing. So you added all the services in the configure services method, and you used constructor to store the important instances, and this method called configure will allow you to configure the app's request pipeline to specify how you are going to handle the HTTP requests. What are the arguments? First of all, IE application builder, IE logger, if you remember my past lecture, previous lecture, this IE logger and IE web host environment. First of all, let me talk about this one and this one. IE application builder and IE logger are available only in this signature. They are available only in the configure method. You will not get them in the constructor. You will not get them in configure services. In fact, configure services you are going to add only. So this is the only place where you can get these two instances. You can add as many arguments to it. For example, you want an iLogger for some other class, a trivial class like string. You can add that also. Runtime will pass every possible argument that you ask if it is available. See, runtime will add every possible argument that you ask for, and if it can make it for you and it makes it available to you in the configure method. So I'll spend some time. We ask for iLogger startup and this will be available to us here, because this logger can be created for the startup class so that we can log messages about the startup class. In fact, if you add any custom service, they will also be made available to you here. You can add appropriate arguments. And if you do not see your service listed here, if you do not want to extend it, then you can get any services by using this. This app instance is very important. See, app is available, app is here. It is used here also, that is, it is being used almost everywhere in this method. And this app itself, this application builder itself, it can be used to get any other service. Get required service is an important method. This T I have added that it is for any type of service you want, of course, provided if it exists. So you can get any services here. You can get them available here. And these two are only available inside configure method. So as an example, app.useRouting, or I think use routing by pronunciation, I'm not sure. App.useRouting I'll call. App.useRouting method, this tells that routing should be used, and use endpoints, it tells how to interpret the various routes. I'm not going into the details of this. This we will tackle in our next lecture. But for the moment, all I can say is that this says when the get request comes / HTTP localhost / nothing after it, then it will simply write hello world to the browser. It will send a response hello world that will be seen on the browser. Don't worry about this. The important point is that app, logger, and any additional service you can obtain through the arguments If you don't want to get from the arguments, then you can make use of app.applicationServices to get the required service instance here itself. This method is compulsory. This method is the most important method. So this method will allow you to specify how you are going to respond to the HTTP requests. We can now study how to configure without a startup class. Without a special startup class, how to configure? Let us try to understand that also. If we remember, go back to our program.cs. Program.cs file. There we used create host builder method, the root start point of the whole thing. Now let us have a look at this method once again, how we can make use of this method to configure our application in exactly the same way as we are doing through our startup class, but this time without a dedicated startup class. This is the simple code for it that you can try to understand. This is inside the method create host builder. Host.default builder is written inside create host builder method in the program.cs file. So you should see the previous lectures to better understand what this is. And here we wrote, if you remember, create default builder was followed by configure web host defaults. And here we wrote use startup startup. We told our runtime to use this startup class, but now let us comment it out and remove it as if we are not going to use this class. Now the question is that your startup class has this application builder and iLogger, etc. I told you just now, I told you in the configure method. I'm talking about the configure method. I'll just now come about the configure services also. So configure method, you will be getting an application builder only. You get the application builder here. But if you want to get iWeb host environment, iConfiguration, these also you want. These services you also want. These you were earlier obtaining through the constructor. And you were also obtaining it through arguments of your configure method. So if you still want these, then you can call app.applicationServices.getRequiredService, iWeb host environment, you get it here, and iConfiguration, you get it here. You can get every service that you want through a structure like this. And then this app is used as usual for use routing, use endpoints. So if you are editing this in your project, then you should add this using Microsoft.ASP.NET Core Builder for this. You will get a small error that can be resolved by this using statement at the top. Okay. So this is the configure method. Then there was a configure services method. We used this method for adding more services. This is also available, webbuilder.configureServices. This is the collection of services that is available to you, and you can do whatever you want here. So basically everything that was available through a dedicated startup class is available to you in the configure web host defaults method through the web builder, webbuilder.configure, webbuilder.configureServices. You can go either way, but usually a startup class is always there. Now, what are iStartup filters? This topic, I'm sure, is not going to be used by you in your day-to-day working. This is only if you are authoring a component and you want to attach some code or want to force that some code should run before the pipeline, or it should run after, then you can use I startup filters concept. Let us see how. This concept, I startup filters, is used to ensure that custom middleware, that your own middleware, your own code, if you are writing a component yourself, if you are a component author, as I already told you, this is not for daily use. This you will not be using it very often, but if you are authoring a component, then you can ensure that your custom middleware, it runs before or after the middleware pipeline configured through the startup class. This is the pipeline that runs due to the startup class. You can put your filter here that this runs first, or you can put it here that this runs after. Let me show you an example. I have taken a screenshot of I added code for I startup filters, and then I obtained a screenshot. This is the default request, and it, as I told you just now, it renders hello world on the screen. I wanted to put a hi before it, so that hi is printed before it. It is printed first, it is written first, and then hello world is written. This is processed first and this is processed second. So we can do it this by prepending an I startup filter. So this is what is the whole concept about. There are various steps of doing it. Let us see what are those steps. Step one is to write your own middleware. This middleware is the code that you want to run before the middleware pipeline configured through the startup class. So what is this? A simple class, my pre-middleware. All middleware classes are by convention prepended with middleware, but this is not compulsory. You could have written my pre also. Okay. The constructor will receive a request delegate. This is passed by the runtime. We cache it as a read-only private here. This is required. This is the skeleton. This is the template that we can use to write our own middleware. So as I'm saying, the constructor will get request delegate. This can be cached here. Next, you will see a public async task invoke. This invoke method will receive the context. This context, as you already know, can allow you to obtain response and request and everything else for the HTTP story. Public invoke or invoke async method must be available on middleware. If this method is not available, then exceptions are thrown. So that is why this method is the one where you are going to response, you are going to write your code that is going to run before the standard pipeline. And to simplify the things, I have written http context.response.write hi. This hi will be written, and after that, this is underscore next. This is the request delegate. This passes on the context to the next filter. Next filter means the standard filter, the pipeline that is being processed through the startup class. So this code I'll make available on the blog page. You can check it out there also. Step two would be to write an I startup filter to configure the middleware. So let us see how this is done. A class my pre filter I startup filter This will configure, this receives an application builder. This is a delegate. And here you tell that we are going to use this middleware, my pre-middleware. This code configures the middleware. It tells the ASP.NET engine that this middleware has to be used. This is the sole purpose. And this is the boilerplate that allows you to pass the call to the next configure. You can have two or three iStartup filters. So this will pass to the next one, to the next one in the chain. So I would say this is mostly a skeleton that you can use to write your own project, to write your own component. This is the key line here. Now, once this is configured, the third step would be to register the iStartup filter in the service container. Let us see how we do that registration. Registration is done through the create host builder in the program.cs file. Create default builder was already there, web host defaults was already there, but you add configure services. And here you add a transient iStartup filter by prefilter. So this filter is added. This is added to the service container. And the code, this filter, as we already know, tells us to use our custom middleware. So that middleware will be run first, and then the standard pipeline will go. And as I have already shown you, the output will be first from our custom middleware and then from the standard pipeline. We can see the completed code also. This is the complete code. This is your program class. Create host builder.build.run. And this is your create web create host builder. And here we are adding our filter, registering it. This is the class middleware class. We get the request delegate. Request delegate is cached as a read-only. Invoke method. This causes this code to run. And this is the iStartup filter. This is your filter. Here you configure and tell that by pre-middleware is to be used. Where is this registered? This is registered here. You will have to take some time to convince yourself and explain yourself. So with this, we can close this lecture. Thank you.